On August 15, 1945, Japan surrendered to Allied forces in the Pacific Theater with the formal instruments of surrender signed on September 2nd. Hostilities between the US and Japan officially ended on the 8th of September 1951, following the San Francisco Peace Conference. What often gets downplayed, if not overlooked, was the Soviet declaration of war on August 9, 1945, and subsequent invasion of Japanese-held territory in Manchuria and Korea. Since the end of the war, Japan and the Soviet Union have failed to sign a formal peace treaty between them. The main reason for a failure to achieve a satisfying peace agreement is a sovereignty dispute over a small group of islands off the northern coast of the Japanese island of Hokkaido. Japan refers to them as the Northern Territories, and they are part of the Chishima Reto Archipelago, which many of you may know as their more familiar name, the Kuril Islands. I'm your host, David, and in today's episode, we're going to review the history of this potential Cold War flashpoint, a tense border dispute which has soured the Soviet-Japanese relationship since 1945. This is the Cold War. We can't say that snacking would have solved the Cold War, but if it could have, the sponsor of this video, Boksu, would have been the best candidate to do so. Boksu offers a truly unique product, a monthly snack box subscription that partners with century-old family snack makers to deliver exclusive Japanese snacks and tea pairings to your door. Every month, you'll receive a box with a different theme and different snacks. It's a gourmet journey through Japan every month. Order Boksu this month and you will get the special box named Tropical Travels, full of snacks with, you guessed it, tropical fruits. Among them is the Okinawa salted shikwasa fried kanikotane. It might be a mouthful to say, but it's extremely tasty. It's a crispy treat with the salty sour flavor of the exotic citrus fruit shikwasa. But be quick, as stocks are limited. Boksu has sent us one of these boxes, and it has everything you need to be in Japanese bliss. Sweet, sour, spicy, fruity. You can order an individual box, single month, or multi-month subscriptions starting at $36.99 per box. Auto-renew with the option to pause or cancel anytime. Your first box will ship out within 1 to 2 weeks straight from Japan. Ordering Boksu is one of the best ways to bring Japan into your home, so get 10% off your own authentic Japanese snack box from Boksu and save up to $47 using our code and link in the description. Don't forget that this also supports our channel. The 56 islands of the Kuril or Chishima Reto Archipelago extend for 750 miles from the southern tip of the Kamchatka Peninsula to the northeastern corner of Hokkaido. They cover a total of 6,000 square miles of territory, separating the Sea of Ohotsk from the Pacific Ocean. In today's episode, we'll focus on just a handful of these islands, the actual bone of contention: Etorofu, Kunashiri, Shikotan, and the Habomai Islets. These are the Northern Territories and closest to Japan. To better understand the roots of this dispute, I will have to take you to an era so remote I didn't even know it existed, the 19th century. Ancient history time. By the early 1850s, as Japan was being open to foreign trade and cannons, the Tsarist government sought to build a good relationship with Japan, mirroring the British and American efforts at commercial and diplomatic expansion in the region. This interest led to the signing of the Russo-Japanese Treaty of Shimoda in 1855. The agreement assigned most of the Kuril Islands to Russia, while Etorofu, Kunashiri, Shikotan, and the Habomai Islets were formally retained by Japan. 20 years later, the Treaty of St. Petersburg revised these clauses. Now, the entire Kuril Chishima Reto Archipelago fell into Japanese hands. In exchange, the Tsar received the whole of Sakhalin Island, which had been co-administered up to that point. But the once friendly nations came to blows in the aptly named Russo-Japanese War of 1904-1905. Following Russia's defeat, the Treaty of Portsmouth assigned the southern half of Sakhalin to Japan. The boundaries shifted again after the October Revolution of 1917, after which Japan took control of the entire island. And then not much changed. Until the Second World War, anyway. In April of 1941, Japan and the Soviet Union signed a short-lived neutrality pact which was then unilaterally abrogated by Stalin on the 8th of August, 1945. At that point, Soviet armed forces then launched a massive offensive in Manchuria, a decisive factor to Japan's surrender on the 15th of August. The Red Army and Navy did not halt their invasion, however, and by the 5th of September, they had taken over all of the Kurils. This move apparently had the blessing of President Roosevelt. Only apparently, though. At the Yalta Conference in February 1945, FDR had agreed to cede the Kurils to the Soviet Union, but not all of them. In one of those minor details in history that actually isn't so minor, the Yalta Agreement never mentioned the word all. It was only in August that FDR's successor, President Truman, granted Stalin occupation rights to all of the Kurils, including the four northern territories, which the Japanese now considered traditionally part of Hokkaido. But there was a misunderstanding. Truman and the State Department intended this to only be a temporary military occupation, to be terminated and the islands returned to Japanese control once a Soviet-Japanese peace treaty was signed. But the mustache had other views. Soviet troops did not display any intention of leaving the archipelago, and in 1947, they expelled the entire Japanese population that was still living there. This was the beginning of a series of tense and convoluted diplomatic confrontations in which Japan tried to wrest control over at least some of the disputed islands. As a result of this ongoing process, the two nations have never actually signed a formal peace treaty. The first showdown was the San Francisco Peace Conference of 1951. The ensuing treaty was signed by 49 countries, including Japan. Article 2C of the treaty stated that, quote, Japan renounces all right, title, and claim to the Kuril Islands. So you would think that that would settle it, right? Well, not really. Prime Minister Shigeru Yoshida verbally acknowledged that the two of the northern territories, Kunashiri and Etorofu, were part of the Kurils, but Shikotan and the Habomai Islets were an integral part of Hokkaido. The US State Department also later clarified that Japan was entitled to those two territories, recognizing them as being part of Hokkaido. On top of that, the Soviet Union had withdrawn from the conference before signing the treaty. And the result? Well, the four northern territories, or southern Kurils, would remain in a state of international limbo. The next round took place in August 1956, during Soviet-Japanese negotiations taking place in London. On that occasion, negotiators from Moscow and Tokyo nearly resolved the territorial dispute. This was the deal. If Japan recognized Etorofu and Kunashiri as part of the Kuril Islands, the Soviets would be ready to return Shikotan and the Habomais. They would also agree to talks about the remaining territories at a future date. This proposal almost reached a satisfactory conclusion and almost got the two countries to sign a peace treaty. Notice I said almost. During the discussions, US Secretary of State John Foster Dulles stepped in with a note to his Japanese counterpart, Mamoru Shigemitsu. Dulles informed Shigemitsu that if Japan did not press claims for Etorofu and Kunashiri, then the US would feel obliged to occupy Okinawa in perpetuity. Dulles actually did this with the best of intentions. The idea was that the specter of a permanent US military presence in Japan could be used by Shigemitsu as a bargaining chip with the Soviets for the return of all four territories. But news of the memo leaked to the Soviets. In their interpretation, Dulles wanted to derail the London talks so that Japan would gravitate away from Moscow and further into the arms of Uncle Sam. In the end, the negotiations did lead to a Soviet-Japanese joint declaration, and while it relieved much of the post-war tension, it was not a peace treaty, and it had not settled the issue of the Kuril Islands. So at this stage, you may be wondering what made these islands so important. Well, from the Soviet perspective, the Kurils had some naval strategic value. They protected the Sea of Ohotsk from enemy navies in the Pacific, and they helped allow nuclear submarines to enter the Pacific Ocean undetected by US surveillance. But their real value was as a political weapon. The issue of the islands allowed Moscow to maintain diplomatic leverage on Japan and its relations with the main players in the Pacific Basin. The resolution of the dispute, or lack thereof, could be used by Soviet foreign ministers as a carrot or a stick to ensure Japan did not get too close to China or the United States. From the Japanese perspective, it was, and actually still is, a matter of national and territorial integrity. The Northern Territories are considered to be a historical, integral part of Hokkaido. A return of the islands to the motherland is also a powerful tool deployed for internal political purposes. A final argument, valid for both contenders, is that the archipelago is one of the world's richest fishing areas with significant economic value. Okay, so now after the 1956 debacle, and despite Soviet efforts, Japan did get cozier with the US, renewing a security treaty in 1960. The following year, Premier Nikita Khrushchev, the Corn Lord himself, declared that territorial issues between Japan and the Soviet Union are resolved. Wait, what? Did we miss something? No, we didn't. What Nikita was actually saying was, I ain't gonna resolve them. Sort of an international version of ignoring a problem in the hopes that it just goes away. Now, more than a decade later, in October of 1973, his successor, Leonid Brezhnev, had to readdress the problem with Japanese Prime Minister Kakui Tanaka, whose aliases include the computerized bulldozer and Yami Shogun, or Shadow Shogun. Tanaka expected to leverage his own country's newfound economic power to extract a deal from Brezhnev. Brezhnev expected to exploit recent American investment in Siberia to reject any proposal from Tanaka. So, another stalemate ahead? Well, not necessarily. The bulldozer had another ace up his sleeve. Following the 1969 border war between the People's Republic of China and the USSR, Sino-Soviet relations were at one of their lowest points. And only recently, China had normalized relationships with both the US and Japan. The Soviets had reason to fear a quasi-alliance between China, Japan, and the US. Maybe it was time to use the Kuril card to put some distance between Beijing and Tokyo. Tanaka was the first to approach the subject, rather poetically. Although a man is not eternal, the humankind will exist always. We must think about our relations. We must solve questions if they exist. There are such questions. He then referred to the four northern territories as a drop in the sea, compared to the immense landmass of the Soviet Union. A drop in the sea, which should not stand in the way of a peace treaty. As the talks dragged on for days, Brezhnev avoided the issue, while Tanaka persisted. Finally, the Soviet premier blurted out, "Yesterday we already expressed our considerations on this question. Perhaps you did not pay sufficient attention to them, so I will repeat them." Brezhnev's considerations being, yes, he realized the need for a peace treaty, yes, he realized a Kuril solution was part of the peace treaty, but no, he wouldn't discuss it then. In the following decade, as the expiry date of the Soviet Union was fast approaching, even if people didn't realize it, Tokyo did not desist. On the 22nd of July, 1988, former Prime Minister Yasuhiro Nakasone met Premier Mikhail Gorbachev in Moscow to refresh Mikhail Sergeyevich's memory on Japanese claims. On this occasion, he rebranded the seizure of the Kurils as a mistake by Stalin, in an effort to distinguish it from foreign policy in general. But Gorbachev rebuffed the argument, stating that both countries should just recognize the de facto post-war boundaries. 3 years later, in April 1991, Gorbachev was in Tokyo to meet the Secretary General of the Liberal Democratic Party, Shintaro Abe. Abe presented an 8-point cooperation plan that could have solved the decades-long dispute. It was about Japan and the Soviet Union co-leading economic, cultural, and academic projects within the disputed territories. This cooperation would set the basis for eventual negotiations over the islands. Unfortunately, Shintaro Abe died in May 1991, only a month later. His immediate successors were not so eager in carrying out his moderate, long-term plans focused on collaboration. Proposals for joint economic development have been resurrected in the late 2010s, but as of today, the territorial dispute over the Southern Kuril Islands, or Northern Territories, whatever you choose to call them, has not yet been resolved. The same also applies to the issue of a formal peace treaty to end the Second World War. Now, Some of you have likely noticed that in all these discussions regarding government talks and proposals, and the inevitable counterproposals, we have not talked about a group where any deal reached would have had the most significant impact. I am, of course, referring to the Ainu people, the original inhabitants of the Kuril Islands. Over the years, the Ainu have been forcibly relocated by both Japanese and Soviet governments to the huge detriment of the people. Their culture, traditions, and even language have largely disappeared through the chaos, and it's only preserved through the hard work of some dedicated historians and linguists. The voice of the Ainu people has not been represented in discussions, but we hope that any future deal between Tokyo and Moscow will recognize the will of the Ainu to help reach a fair and equitable conclusion. We hope that you have enjoyed today's episode, and to make sure you don't miss all of our future episodes, please make sure you subscribe to our channel and clearly delineate how much of the bell button you are pressing so that 80 years later it's not still under discussion. We can be reached via email at thecoldwarchannel@gmail.com, and we're active on Facebook and Instagram at @thecoldwartv. If you enjoy our work, please consider supporting us via www.patreon.com/thecoldwar or through YouTube membership. And don't forget, the trouble with the Cold War is that it doesn't take too long before it gets heated.